Hello guys, Daz here, and today we're going to be going through a couple of versions of a map that I worked on about a year ago, maybe a bit more, called Factory for Half-Life 2 Episode 2. This is a map that I worked for a couple of weeks on and then gave up on because I just didn't like it. There were a lot of mistakes in it and I figured I'd just give up and start a new map rather than try and fix everything. So what we're going to do is we're going to go through, there are four different versions of the map that I'm going to go through, and we're going to have a look at how it changes each time, and just kind of the things that are wrong with it basically. I'm going to be quite hard on myself. So this is less of a gameplay video and more of a level design critique. So if you're watching this video hoping for some cool gameplay, probably not the video for you. Have a look at some other videos on my channel. That'd be more suited to your thing. This video is more for level designers and people with an interest in level design. So, without further ado, let's get on with it. If I can spell factory correctly, there we go. Alright. So here we are, this is the first version of the map. As you can see, we're in some kind of outside area. I wanted to let the player explore this big facility, basically. So I wanted to start them out on the outside and then let them explore all the different areas inside the facility. Let me see if we've got the crashed Combine helicopter here. I wanted to give some context to how the player got here. So a bit of environmental storytelling. The player crashed here in this helicopter, which he must have stolen from somewhere. Again, don't really like it. If I worked on the map more, I probably would have added a little, perhaps a little cutscene or something at the beginning with the player crashing into this area. So if we go this way, there is absolutely nothing. Let's take a look inside. I don't like it when doors open outwards. I don't know, maybe it's just my little preference thing, but doors should open away from the player rather than towards them. Just makes it easier to navigate. And again, I've gone way over the top with the glow effects on lights and HDR. So you can see this, it's almost looks like a sun indoors here. Pretty ridiculous. Again, this one's too strong as well. It looks okay from far away, but when you get close it flares out quite badly. When you're putting glows in a map like this, you want to start off with a low value and then just increase it until it looks right, rather than starting too high and just leaving it. Okay, so we've got a pistol. If we go over here, we can see there's just some random junk on the floor. A hole in the wall. You'll see in later versions of the map I changed this, because I didn't really like having a random hole in the wall here with nothing behind it. Again, the player's meant to be in this big facility and it just looks empty with stuff like this. There should be something behind it. We've got a Combine light here. I don't know how I managed this, but the light from it lights all the props but not the environment. Pretty strange. So if we go this way, I don't think there's anything behind this door yet. No. That's for later versions of the map. Get a crowbar. And again, we're just getting weapons randomly here, there's no kind of build up. I didn't even see the crowbar there before I picked it up. And some things I like about this area, it's got some hidden little pickups which you can find. If you look up there, there's a weapon crate. Unfortunately, the problem is that you can't actually get it down from there. There's another one in here. And And again, you'll probably notice in a lot of my Half-Life 2 videos I moan about static props getting in the way, sorry, not static props, physics props getting in the way of the player. In this area I try to keep them all away from the main path through the area, so you see the area through here is very clear and you've got all the props on the sides. Just makes it easier to navigate. You see I've got some barnacles up there. Just get rid of that one. We've got our first big fight here. And I'm probably gonna die. Again, this is the problem with this area, there's just, when you come into it, there's no cover. The Combine has all the advantages. And I actually have no ammo now either. I'll just slap God Mode on, because, there we go. Because, again, I just want to show you this area, not actually play. I'll just get rid of you. So you can see, as you come in here, you've got no cover. The Combine's got all the cover here. There's actually nowhere to go to get behind any cover unless you just run blindly through here. This is something, if you have a big combat area like this, you want the player to be able to explore it slightly before they get into combat. And here's another problem, getting caught on props in a combat area that is so bad. You want the player to be focusing on their position in the environment and the combat itself, rather than how do I get around this stupid prop. Right. So yeah, the idea behind this area was have a cool multi-leveled area where the player can run around and engage the Combine. And have lots of different routes the player can take, but what ended up happening is you run into an area without any cover and just get annihilated by the Combine soldiers pretty much instantly. And from a visual standpoint, this area doesn't really make sense. I mean, you're meant to be inside a kind of factory stroke power station industrial facility, and this area just, it just doesn't fit in with that theme in my opinion. And you've got the water down here, you know, why is there water in a power station? What? Some of the things I do like from this that I actually carried on to later versions of the maps are these pillars with the metal bars going through them. Yeah, I actually used them in later versions of the map. And these kind of sewer grates here you'll see in later versions as well. You will notice the complete lack of development textures as well. Again, this is the very first version of the map that I made. And I spent a whole lot of time on detailing and lighting and all this stuff. And you'll see in the second version, this area gets scrapped entirely. So it was just a complete waste of time to texture and light it all and add all this detail. So if you're new to mapping and you're making Half-Life 2 level, it's very tempting to just go all out in detail like this straight away and have a cool looking map, but at the end of the day, if it doesn't play well, it's just going to be a giant waste of time. So experiment with the dev textures first, just block everything out very simply, check that the gameplay's fun, and then start detailing up afterwards. I think that's everything that's in this version. Just check up here. Okay, we're going to load up the next version now and see what changes. Alright, so we can see a couple of changes already. I've got rid of the tunnel here and just added a Combine barrier. See, I added the little brush-based spikes on the walls there. great thing about combine architecture is that you can just kind of fit it in anywhere with just little spikes coming out like this, and very, very angled geometry. It'll fit just about anywhere if you do that. This area in the previous level just served no purpose, so I just removed it. We can also see I removed the walkway across the top here, and added the lookout post there. Also, you notice the skybox is a bit better. We've got some mountains on the horizon there. I think that's all I changed in this area. So let's go inside. You see if we get the crowbar here now. And I added these destructible boards here so that the player would have to get the crowbar to proceed. So a bit of gating there just to make sure the player finds the crowbar. You can't actually proceed without it. Doors open inwards this time. Hooray. Yeah, I think this area is the same. No changes. Oh, I may have toned down the lens flare a bit there. That looks a bit better. We've got a little bit more detail in this area now. The ceiling's still a bit bare. If you want to have a lot of fun with geometry as a level designer, always put it up high where the player can't get to it. Again, you want to keep the gameplay areas very functional, very clean, so the player can navigate them easily. If you want to put in a lot of crisp detail and interesting things like that, always put it where the player can't actually get to it. Here we see this area is a bit different now. See, I removed the sky here. Just added some destruction there. All this is just cut out parts of the geometry there, added a displacement surface at the back, and then filled it with rubble props. Added some pipes there as well. It's quite a nice effect, I think. Again, we've got some this side. Again, same thing. Displacement brush at the back, and then just some rubble props. I think it looks quite nice. Then we've got the combine force fields here, and the lighting from the combine light actually works now as well. Okay, let's see what else. Oh, I actually removed that ammo pickup. Yeah, it was a bit weird trying to get to it without a gravity gun or something. A grenade. So again, breaking down these to get in. Oh, and it's different now. I don't know why I removed the barnacles from up there. I thought they were quite good. Not really sure why I removed them. So yeah, this area is completely new. Let's see, we've got a metro cop over there. Let's go and see if we can sneak up on him. Yeah. And that's how I gave the player a pistol now, rather than just having it lying around in the environment. Okay, so see up there's an ammo pickup. There we go. Him. Now, I kind of like this area. Again, I asked the question of what is the point of this area, like from an architectural point of view. I just kind of went mad and made this room and added a bunch of walls and little curvy bits. And this is probably something I struggle with a lot coming from Quake mapping, where you can kind of get away with making anything you like. And in Half-Life 2 you have to kind of be a bit more considered. It has to resemble a real place somewhat. So, although I like the look of this area, it's I question what it's actually for from a real life perspective. But I like the fact that it's open to the sky. I added some trees and rocks up there. vines coming down the walls. Let's carry on, shall we? Oh. Nice little scripted moment there. You'll notice in the next version of the map, I actually tighten up the timing on this quite a bit. You'll notice as I ran down here, the debris fell down, and then there was like a couple of seconds gap before you saw the first combine. It didn't feel quite right to me, so in the next version of the map, these combines actually fall down a lot quicker after the debris. And in this area, I kind of played with the tone mapping settings a bit. I kind of had the idea that you're in a dark area, so the lights are going to be a bit brighter. So in this area only, the tone mapper is scaled up a bit, so you get some flaring on the lights there. So we got some suit power we can charge up on. Again, we've got the light map scale here, so you can get the cool shadows on the walls. I think this is a light map scale of 1 or 2. It's very, very low. Again, I don't see it's used enough in Half-Life 2 maps. I really like this effect. You can make some really great looking shadows with it. And if you're looking at this and you're wondering how the hell do I do that, in the editor, just select the faces that you want, and there's an actual box in the editor for light map scale. I think 16 is the default, and you can lower it down to 1 or 2 to get a really high res crisp light map. Just be warned that don't use it absolutely everywhere, because it'll eat up texture memory like there's no tomorrow. Alright, let's carry on. So in another area, got some rocks up there. Again, this is something I dislike about the map in general, there's so many different environment types. So you've got the alpine start area with the mountains. And then you've got this area of like rocks and kind of a abandoned facility feeling. And then as you'll see in a minute, you get another environment type, and it's just not consistent enough. So you go around here. This will be expanded on the next version of the map, so I'll talk about it then. Again, light map scale. Get some great shadows. Come up here. Oh, what's this? A giant radio tower. I think I went a bit overboard on the size, but I kind of like it. Yeah, and now you'll see a lot of problems with this area. Generally, you have the same kind of problem. There's just not enough. You're attacking into a fortified position with not enough cover. Especially with the mounted gun there, you can kind of run and hide behind this, but there's just not enough flanking cover, so you end up just having to like run around here and hope for the best. Get this guy. Die. Okay. So yeah, this area. I think this is one of the first areas where I actually used displacement surfaces in a big way. I was kind of learning as I went, as I placed these. And you can see some of it isn't the best, it's quite low poly. I think I used power of 4 or 3 for these. They probably could have done with something a bit more crisp. So you can see. Again, when I added this area, I decided to work on the skybox a bit, which is why I added the mountains and whatnot in. And even though you've got all these displacement surfaces here, it still feels very square. You can kind of tell where I made the brushes and then just converted them to displacements and extruded them a bit. Alright. It can't actually get down there. I just wanted to make it feel like this was a rocky area with multiple paths, but in actual fact it's very linear. I think I removed this in the next version. And again, if I just stop, there's absolutely no sound, no ambience whatsoever. Soundscapes are so important in a game like this. That adds so much atmosphere. I'm seeing a problem there. Probably don't need to tell you what it is. This is an area I really like in this map, but it's not really fully completed in this version. So the idea with these hunters is, in this area I wanted them, I really wanted to feel like you were being stalked by them. Unfortunately some of the setup and triggering just isn't correct in this version. It gets a lot better in the next version, I believe. So you come around here, let me open the door with that. Again, there's some triggering here to like turn this light off, but the actual button isn't triggered very well, doesn't change colour or anything like that. I fixed that in the next version. But generally, when you're using buttons like this, you want to make it obvious that it's been pressed. Like for instance, changing the red light to green. And again, with this door, obviously it was closed a minute ago, but I wanted to show the player where to go with these cables, so you kind of flow the cables around to the command console there. And here we are. I really like this barn area. I think it's cool to have kind of ancient technology areas and then overtake them with combine architecture like this. So you can see, you can still see parts of the barn, but you've just got these combine wall panels that are slowly being created to convert this barn into a combined stronghold. You've got a holographic screen there. Not visible enough in this version of the map, I fix it in the next one. But it actually shows the combined force fields from the start of the map. You'll also notice I've gone a bit overboard on the HDR bloom effects in here as well. The idea was that all this fog was like hurting your eyes or something like that, so I wanted to really increase the bloom to give that effect, but I'm not sure if it works too well. That is it for this version of the map. But again, around here I'm not too much of a fan of these walls. Again, it just feels like, you know, you built four brushes around the side of this area and then just converted them to displacement surfaces. And again, you got stuff like this. Amateur mistake. Yeah. I think that's just about everything for this version of the map. Yep. So, let's go on to the next one. See, now we've got a proper intro with the level description. Perhaps the black lasts a bit too long, but you've got the intro music as well. You see we've added a little bit more detail up here. You've got the structure up there. I think I added a little bit more detail to this outside area, a few more rocks and plants and things like that. He wasn't there before. I think apart from that this area is about the same. So we'll blast through this part because you've already seen it. So we've got some ambient sounds now, just to add a little bit of atmosphere. I think I tweaked this a bit here. Made the lighting look a bit better on it. And you can see there's actually something through there now. We'll get to that later. That door through there leads to the HEV suit charging area that you saw before. So it's just a quick route back here as you come back from earlier. We'll grab this stuff because we're probably going to need it. I hate this. This isn't actually a physics prop, it's a brush which I just made, but it's really annoying to kind of jump over. Again, I think this area is pretty much identical. I don't think I changed it at all. I was quite happy with it at the time. Give me your stuff. So again, watch. There you go. The triggering just feels a lot better like that. You see the debris come down and then you see the soldiers almost instantly afterwards. It just feels a lot better. I think I'll speed up this suit charging bit. You've already seen it once, you don't need to see it again. So you can see we've added a bit more detail here now. You probably recognise these pillars from the very first version of the map. I thought this area needed a little bit more detail. You see it's... Again, we've got the displacement surface inside the brushes, just to give it that broken feel. And now we have soldiers here. And now that brings me to this area. I wanted to give a couple of choices to both the soldiers and the player of how to attack this part. So you can see the soldiers come down here, you can fight them here, or you can run up here. This area is new. Again, detail up high where the player can't reach it, you can go nuts. And that brings you out here. I mean, you could run up the stairs here and fight it head on, or you can go around the side. Or you can kind of stay in the tunnel around the back there. I think these soldiers actually blew themselves up with a grenade. How very clever. I think the only other... yeah, I added this here. Just to give some extra ammo, as there are a few more bad guys now. So yeah, this area here. Again, I just wanted to give a few more options to the player for how they attack that fight. So you can kind of flank around up here. I think the stairwell's a bit small, to be honest. I don't know. I like this though at the top. Again, you can put cool stuff like this away from the player and gives them something nice to look at without getting in their way. So let's carry on, see what's different. Oh. You'll notice these walls are a lot taller now. I think this area looks so much better just by raising these cliffs a bit more. You see we've got a combine light there now. There's a little bit more cover, but still not enough. What this area really needed was a way to flank around And again, I think it gets a bit too dark down here now. Since I've raised the cliffs, the light doesn't get in as much. It can be quite hard to see where to go. But yeah, this area still has the same problem, where this guy's just annoying as hell. And there's just not enough. Perhaps fell some rocks here, which kind of blocked his line of sight a bit. Perhaps some more over here. There we go. So I think this area looks okay. Again, you can really tell these rocks need some more polygons on them now, since I've raised them up. I don't think I actually bothered rebuilding them, I just raised them up. But yeah, you can almost count the polygons on them now. Again, I did some ambience in there now, so you've got some birds playing, you've got the wind blowing. It's night and day the difference some good ambience can make. Okay, we've got some more detail here, the power lines. And you can already tell this area's more fleshed out now. So you've got the extra barn up there, a couple of extra props. You'll notice, he's not there now. So the player has no idea what's about to happen. These rocks I hate. I don't know why I added them there, it's just completely random. Got like gravity defying boulders. I'm going to talk a little bit about the front of this. It's like, wow, it's the front of a barn. But it's just little things you can do to break up the walls. So ignore these. I hate this texture along here. I think it's a texturing error by me, that. So pretend that isn't there. But like these windows, you'll notice they've got little window edges on them. And you've got a slight kind of edge around the door there. And what it does is, if you look at it from an angle like this, it adds so much extra detail to the surface, rather than it just being a flat, dull surface. You just add a little bit of three-dimensional detail to it, maybe a prop or two like I've got here, and a couple of decals or overlays, whatever you fancy using. It just makes it so much better looking. You'll notice here, I haven't added the windowsills or anything like that, and it just looks like a flat surface. Just a couple of little details like that can make such a difference to walls and other areas. So now we see him. The triggering's a lot tighter now, so you kind of get a glimpse and he runs away. That's what I was going for. Okay, we've got some ambience now, so adding some suspense for what's inside there. Oh, we see him again there. Yeah, and we heard him that time. So yeah, you notice the triggering's a lot better here now. You've got the light changing colour. The sound for the door opening. Much better. Got some pickups in here now. Another supercharger. Yeah. It's always fun to mess with the player's head like this. If you can create anticipation for something that's about to happen, just with atmosphere like this, works so well. So you can see here we've got the combined force fields. Press that. And they're off. And I think there was meant to be like a combined siren that goes off now as well, which is why all these control panels turn red when you press the button. I must not have triggered it up correctly in this version. But yeah, this is where the player's meant to stop panicking, basically. Oh, and here he is. He drops down. Again. The reveal animation isn't quite right there, so he kind of drops down and then disappears back up again. It's not set up right. But you get the idea. You walk out and he drops down to scare you like that. Oh. Yeah, and now his friends turn up. Yeah. And he's out of there. I don't think I had any pickups around here. Let's have a look. Right. Like you say, I added the wood pile being held there. I think the original plan was you could drop it on something to kill it, but that never really worked out. It was too much of a pain to get something to stand there and then drop it. So I just kind of removed that and left it as a just an interesting little detail in the map. Alright. Now, pressing that button has obviously alerted the Combine forces, so we're going to have to fight our way back out of here as well. Now what I did with the spawns here, I think I spawned 6, maybe 7 soldiers. There's actually about 14 different spawn points. So it's actually different every time on the way back here. It looks like most of these spawns happened in this area, but there's actually a bunch of spawns back down the corridor and towards the start. And that's a great way to add replayability. Because again, there are spawn points up here, so they kind of act like snipers. There's spawn points behind here, so there could be another guy on that gun. Or they could have all spawned back near the start and rush you as you come back down the water-filled passages. You never really know where they're going to be. Grab this health pack. Okay, and I think this is the version where there's actually a completely new area, if I'm remembering correctly. We all see soon. You see the spawning here is a bit broken, they kind of appear right in front of you. I think that's just because I hadn't finished properly. Oh no, the next area must be in the next version. Okay. Well, alright then, let's load the next one. This is the final one, so we can kind of go into a bit more analysis after this. There you go, it fades in a bit quicker this time. So you can kind of tell, things do kind of tighten up as you go through the different revisions of the map. You always want to question everything you're working on as you make these different iterations. Yeah. Still lens flare overload. Right, I think I'm just going to dart through these areas, as you've all seen them 3 times already. But there are still little things here and there that have changed, so if I see anything, I'll mention it. He doesn't want to come out to play. Fine. Oh, I think he saw me. Maybe he didn't. Well, this should be a bit different then, as they haven't seen me until I've got up here. So they're all going to be searching for me now. Again, having combat setups like this, it's really important, I feel. If you let the player approach combat on their own terms. It's just a way to alleviate a bit of frustration of having combat forced down your neck in a place that perhaps you maybe don't want to fight. This is probably one of my favourite areas of this entire map, to be honest. I like the fact that you can almost get through this entire area without being seen. If you play carefully, you can get all the way up here. I never actually tested to make sure, but you might actually be able to get all the way through without actually anyone seeing you at all. So, this area is the same, I think. And again, this is the problem. It's going to be a fun combat area, but you spend all of it hiding behind a stack of wooden logs. Which is a shame, because I kind of like the idea of it. You walk out the door and you just see this huge fortification with lots of cover everywhere, and it looks really fun, but when you actually get to it, it doesn't quite work. So we're going to leg it through here. I don't think this area's changed. Yeah, maybe that's a bit too obvious. It's scripted there. If you kind of run past, you can tell that nothing's actually there. Give me your stuff. I do like this room, I just think the HDR's overdone in it. Okay, let's do this. Did I fix the alarm sound in this version? No, I didn't. Again, I think having to fight a hunter in this little room is probably maybe a mistake as well. It's a bit too small for them to really navigate around in properly. Maybe this whole area in general is just too small for them. It's a lot of narrow passages. Now we live and learn. Let's see where they spawn this time. So we've got a couple of soldiers here, it's less than last time. No one up there this time. I think I may have attached all these soldiers to the same squad name, so I think they all activate when one sees you. He wasn't there last time. Oh, that might be all of them actually. Now I know for a fact that there's a big final area in this that... What? Oh, you cheeky devil. Must have been hiding in the stairwell somewhere. Yeah, as I was saying, I have a lot of problems with the final area I added in this map that we'll go through in a minute. These guys are still spawning from thin air. Good job, Daz. Good job. Alright. I didn't actually add any detail to this corridor, as you can probably tell. But here we go. So, we have our airship fight. And you can see already, there's quite a large problem here. Yeah. Again, even with this glass breakable, I think there's too much cover here. You can just kind of sit here and ignore him almost. Oh, okay. So again, I actually ended up removing a lot of the scenery off the top of here, just so the gunship could get more angles on you. But even then, it's kind of... yeah. He just kind of disappears for long periods of time. You're not sure where he is. I think that's a problem with the pathing I've done for him, rather than a problem with the map. Where is he? Oh, there he is. Yeah, I put a long sweeping path for him around the back of the level, and it just takes him way too long to navigate it. Run. So the basic idea was, I haven't actually got anything to take him down yet, so the idea was that he would harass you for a while as you kind of navigate around this area of the map. And then at the end there's actually a rocket launcher with a box of ammo, so you can finally take him down. See? Come through there and get me. Again, the pathing's just incorrectly done here, so again he's disappeared now, I have no idea where he's gone. Yeah, well, we'll carry on. Oh, he's finally made it around here. Yeah, okay. And now we're out here, and this area is unfinished, but the plan was you kind of dodge him all around here, come down. Let me just turn on God mode for this, as I'm going to talk a lot. Then he would attack you here, and you'd run down into the parking garage here. Identify known clip quickly. The parking garage would kind of come around here, and then you'd exit through this tunnel, which brings you out into here. Hello? Got ammo pack in the car there. And there's the rocket launcher up there. Perhaps it's not too obvious. The idea was that you climb up all this rubble, which hasn't been clipped over properly, you can tell. I'm actually stuck here now. Work in progress, guys, work in progress. So you climb over this, jump onto this. Then you can kind of use these panels attached to the side for cover as he's attacking you. Then you just kind of leg it. And here we go. Oh. Again, another problem with this area. He's not high enough in the air and he's too far away. It's just irritating to fight him like this. I mean, look, where's he gone now? Come on, man. Yeah, again, the pathing is everything with these guys. It can be so irritating if they don't go to the right areas properly. I think he's going along. Yeah, he's coming around his path around the back. And again, look, he's just hiding behind the trees here. And it's just annoying. You have to kind of stand in here even to just get him to come closer. Yeah. Move along here, nothing to see. Oh, and of course I need... Ugh. Yeah, this is the problem. You drop down to get them to come closer, and then you'd have to jump all the way through here just to go up here to get more rockets. Not ideal. So we'll just grab some more rockets and take him down. Hello? So there we go. Again, this arena, I had some good ideas for it, but the execution is just very poor, I think. This area is okay. I like the idea that you can... There's like a little maze to go around, with little pockets for him to shoot you from. Makes it quite exciting, dodging from cover to cover. So I think that bit's okay. Perhaps he needs more areas to shoot you from, though. It can actually be quite easy to just leg it through here and ignore him completely, which is not what the gameplay's meant to be about. Again, this area, the path thing for the gunship kind of destroys the gameplay in this area. He'll just get lost for almost a minute at a time as he goes around this huge path I've put for him at the back here. And again, this bit's too fiddly. You know, if I'd made the parking garage, you'd come out here, and you have to mess around on all this, and then run around in here. And if the box of rockets was down on the floor here, it would be so much better. Because having to do all this again just to get more rockets would just be irritating as hell. And you'll notice that over here is the start of the level. I suppose this lets me talk slightly about visibility. As you can tell that these areas are connected. And what should happen is this area shouldn't be drawn when you're over here. Actually, if I lock the PBS, I think it's still visible, yeah. So, if you're not sure what I've done, lock PBS basically locks the visibility set that you can currently see. So, for example, I'm in this area, I lock the PBS, and because I can't see... Oh my god. Yeah, because I can't see this corridor, it's not rendered at all. It doesn't update where I am in the map for the potentially visible set. And this area here should not be visible from my position. It's a optimization issue. So there should be a... some hint brushes or an area portal here to stop this entire area from being rendered. It's just a giant waste of resources. I mean, obviously these props have to be rendered, but all the geometry down here, all these props, doesn't need to be rendered at all. So yeah, we'll undo that. So, let's have a look around and see if there's anything else I'd like to comment on. You notice here, again, talking about optimization. You want to remove as many faces as you can that the player will never see. So for instance, these here. The player's never going to see those faces from down here. So, just remove them. They don't need to be there. And for instance, these faces here, they're all gone. All the faces of the top here. You can see, they're not there, the player's never going to see them. Get rid of them. Even here, on the top of this thing, look, there's actually a hole there. The player can never get up high enough to see that face, so... kill it. Anything here that I want to talk about? Well, it looks like I did add some detail to the ceiling here, these things. Again, a little bit of three-dimensional detail works wonders on a flat surface like this. I mean, you can barely see it, but like there, it just adds that little bit of extra detail that the player can notice, rather than just having a big flat surface there. Anything else? If we go up here... Oh! See, these faces... The player's never going to see them, they don't need to be there. It's just a waste of resources there. Well, not quite sure what's going on there. Again, these faces are a waste. Let's see here. No, nothing here that I really want to talk about. Oh, damn Steam overlay, the bane of my existence. I think I've pretty much discussed everything I wanted to say. Yeah, you'll notice here again, all the surfaces the player can't see. You can kill them all. And even like the wooden platforms here. If you look from underneath, they look fine. Up above, oh, missing. Yeah, it's a really important optimization technique. You can, overall it might not seem like a lot, but over the course of an entire level you can actually save a fair amount of resources by doing that. Outside, man. Here you can tell, if you look down it from above, you can tell where I've just made rectangular brushes and just turned them into turn them into displacement surfaces. It's always worth hiding it a bit better than that, I think. And again, amateur attempts here. there's a lot of places like this. Again, I think this is the first level I made with a decent attempt at displacement surfaces, and it's okay, but it's certainly not what I would consider acceptable. I mean, stuff like this, it just looks messy, even from down here where the player would be. You've just got that, it just sticks out like that, and it's not good. Okay, I actually can't think of anything else to say, so I'm going to cut this video off here. please let me know if you found this interesting. I mean, if you're a level designer and you looked at this and you just thought, what the hell is this guy on about, let me know as well, because I want these videos to be informative. If I skipped over anything that you wanted to know about, again, let me know, and I will... In fact, if there are enough comments asking about things which I haven't talked about, I'll just go ahead and make another video, if there's enough interest, and talk about all the things I didn't talk about this time. And I'll probably do this as a little mini-series, going through a load of maps I've made, both released and unreleased, talking about the design process I use, and stuff like that. Alright. I will stop flying around and end this video. So, okay guys, this has been Daz, and I'll see you next time.